Talking of which, what's your take on the Jonathan Ross, Russell Brand situation? Russell Brand has now gone. Let's get it out of the way.
Well, what do you want me to say? I know Jonathan, and he knows he's going to come into some serious stick now. He hands out, he's going to take it. Look, he knows he made a mistake. And for me, it's not a matter of whether they should be fired or not, or whether it broke the broadcast laws, because that's not really their fault, you know, that it was pre-recorded. Someone shouldn't have put it out.
But a line was kind of crossed.
Well, yes, his big mistake was actually leaving a message on a real person's phone. And I feel uncomfortable sort of talking about it, but would I do it? No. Did they cross the line? They know they did. Yeah. They know they did. And, you know, it's... I know. Yeah. But I don't think I have to add to the debate now, is my honest answer.
It is.
Well, I look forward to discussing your film.
You've brought the whole mood down.
The whole mood down.
It started off... Yeah. Three Golden Globes.
It speaks nicely to our first item, actually. The debate about who you can feel free to offend and how you offend them comes down to where you do draw this imaginary line in the sand.
It's an argument that lies at the heart of the ever-fierce debate about political correctness. Does it amount to a proper sensitivity?
Or has it gone way beyond what sensitive or even sensible? A question for Hardeep Singh Kohli.
It's a library. Political correctness. Noun. The avoidance of forms of expression or action that are perceived to exclude, marginalise or insult groups of people who are socially disadvantaged or discriminated against.
This fear of causing offence has led some more extreme advocates of political correctness to try and banish words like black, bald and even short. But are we being oversensitive?
I've come to Manchester, or should that be Person Chester, or should that be non-gender specific Chester, to see if I can get through the day without stepping on anyone's PC toes.
Hello, sir. I'd like to stop you for a cup of coffee, please.
How would you like it?
I'll have a black coffee. I'll have a white a coffee of colour. Do you know what? A cup of tea.
See, that's not a black cab. No, that is a cab of colour. Hear me, brothers. That man's not bald. He's follically challenged.
But I don't need to be so PC with this woman. No, she thinks it causes more harm than good.
People who set out to do good, you know, effectively, they think it's a nice idea that we should have all this sort of schemes and plans and ideas and we shouldn't say this and we shouldn't say that. But in the end, it causes a lot of resentment. It can create problems within communities that simply didn't exist before.
But do you not see how political correctness came from a good place?
Yeah, absolutely. It's all very well-meaning. I think the problem is in its application, and it's supposed to be all about tolerance and decency and being, you know, nice to our fellow human beings. But in actual fact, it's very intolerant of anybody who doesn't conform.
But even critics like Laura believe the media are responsible for a number of urban myths about political correctness. So do people really believe what they read in the papers?
Is it true or false that Birmingham City Council banned Christmas and replaced it with the Winterval Festival?
That's true.
You seem very confident.
I've heard the story before.
It's in fact false. They
Is
never
it really
did it.
False?
It was a rumour. Did Newcastle City Council ban men from calling women pet in the workplace? True or false?
Probably true.
Was it a good thing that they banned it?
Well, some people might be upset by it. I wouldn't be.
Police put booties on sniffer dogs when they search Muslim premises. True or false?
False.
What booties?
You two can go. You come with me. False.
Whether such examples are true or not, Roy Hattersley is terrier-like in defending the correct use of language.
Like everything else, political correctness can be overdone. I prefer to be called overweight than abdominally challenged. It's the language that we use in everyday conversation that has to reflect our proper attitude towards the groups which are particularly vulnerable. We're not politically correct about the rich and the powerful, the royal family, the prime minister. We're politically correct about people who need protecting.
Well, a compelling argument from a persuasive gent. And of course, there's a lot to be said about treating each other in a civilised way. But isn't political correctness pushing common sense to places it ought not to be, making a mockery out of stuff that shouldn't be mocked.
You can always rely on students to fight for what they believe is right. But in Manchester, Personchester, they've kicked up a right stink. These toilets in the student union have been degendered. Out go the ladies and the gents, and in come toilets and toilets with urinals.
The toilets have been provided for men who don't self-identify as men and women who don't think of themselves as women. And whether or not this is political correctness gone mad, because it certainly seems that way to some members of our student community.
I think political correctness gone mad is in itself an unpolitically correct term. I don't think
Why?
It is. Because using the term mad in a derogatory fashion is disabling.
Now listen, political correctness isn't of itself an evil thing. It was designed to protect people's feelings, to make them feel included. If, however, we're allowing political correctness to become a weapon to stop us communicating, if we can't talk to each other, we can't learn. And if we can't learn, we can't grow to love each other as a society. I love you all of you.
The message of love, we all appreciated that, Hardeep.
Yeah.
What would your general conclusion be on the issue?
Well, I think political correctness was absolutely necessary and served a function at a certain time in our development, but I think it's now become an obstacle. People often want to ask me about my turban and ask me stuff like that. I mean, Ricky was asking me all sorts of really politically incorrect questions in the green room earlier on, and I just want to set the record straight that I'm not doing that thing again. But I think people should be allowed to be curious and inquisitive.
Yeah.
You know, but I think there are certain words where we're simply not allowed to use the sort of language Ricky was using off air. I mean, you can't really say that.
But it is a podcast available now.
There is a podcast.
Yeah,
available.
Of course.
But I think, you know, we have to be able to ask people questions, and we can't allow our society to be run by minuscule, you know, amounts of people. You know, I mean, it's men's and women's toilets. If you're transgender, you know where to go.
Just choose.
The disabled toilets where everyone else goes.
You're not going to stand outside there crossing your legs saying, I'm not going in either of these, there's not one for me.
Or just in your trousers, like I just did. They rushed me through going, oh, we've got to go in there. So I went. I think he's right. I think there was a case for it, and there still is a case for it. And I think, as you said in the film, that political correctness comes from a good place. And there are a few examples that obviously embarrass the whole cause. But, I mean, it's a student union. When I was a student, I think one student union voted in a dog its president one year, which was, you know, hilarious, and then the next year it voted in a police murderer, which isn't so funny, but that's what they do. They're trying to get a reaction. I remember one of the first AGMs I went to at my college, it was UCL demands troops out of Ireland. I imagine that they were quaking in their boots going, like, let's get out. Some people dressed like Duran Duran want us out, let's get out. It doesn't count.
You really conscious of it?
I imagine in 3 years they're going to be embarrassed about their
actions. Yeah.
It just doesn't count.
You've got to be aware of it, though, when you're writing extras in the office
and everything
else. You kind of always tiptoe around certain things.
Well, I think people mistakenly lump me in with some non-PC comedians, and I don't think I'm non-PC. I think I'm very PC. I'm not one of these comedians that thinks comedy is your conscience taking a day off, and I think our targets are real in the extras in the office.
Yeah.
OK, let's... if you've got a view on political correctness, do get in touch with us on the website. But let's talk about your film, Ghost Town. I went to see it the other night. You play... What can we say? You play a British dentist in New York.
I don't do accents.
No, you're not a... not a particularly nice... not a particularly nice fella in this film. Here you are having a little argument in a hospital.
Date of birth?
Why?
What day were you born?
No, I understood the question. Why do you need to know that?
Let's leave it blank. Weight?
Last night or this morning?
You pick.
182 pounds.
Number of alcoholic beverages consumed per week?
Why do you need to know that?
Well, they want to know.
Well, I'm sure they want to know a lot of things, but I don't want my intimate details auctioned off to the highest bidder, willy-nilly.
Did you drink the laxative solution?
Yes.
Did it work?
It was as advertised.
So it seemed to me what a wonderful life it reminded me of.
And me too, and that's what attracted me to it. I mean, I've been offered like films ever since The Office went out, and I turned them all down, not because they were bad particularly, and some of them were, but because I wasn't looking, I was doing my own thing, and this one came along, and it was the best script I'd read in five years, and
it was funny from page one, and it was very me. I love this this sort of misanthropic, wisecracking
and the romantic
guy.
Lead at the same time.
Well, yeah, I mean, I must say to people who are thinking of going to see it, and go and see it. I mean, it's a lovely film, isn't it?
My 10-year-old daughter loves it. She wants to see it again.
Well, she shouldn't have been there. She's 12.
my 12-year-old daughter of colour went to see it.
Did you give her cigarettes as well? This is unbelievable.
If you ever need reminding, by the way, the BBC gives a fair bit of house room to stuff that spreads nothing but unadulterated joy, the new update adaptation of Little Dorrit might just be that reminder.
But taking us back to the time of Dickens can be a tricky business. Viewers can get very picky about the period look of the whole thing. Lucy Siegel's been to see just how hard the designers strive to get the detail right.
I don't know about you, but I love a good period drama. Rolling countryside, fabulous frocks, sumptuous feasts, and of course, dashing leading men. Observing this process has been fascinating. Nothing is entirely as it seems. That's not even a real wall. I'll certainly be watching Little Dorrit with a more appreciative eye for detail.
Thank you very much, Lucy. Well, maybe you could do Dickens sometime. That'd be a little
I don't wear
avenue
wigs.
For you. No, just don't do wigs.
I don't do accents. I like to get there 5 minutes before I'm on. Yeah, that's an extra hour in bed.
That's a lot of
blank. Fair enough, yeah. I've got to go back to Extras, Ricky. It is my favourite series. And I was watching the Christmas special again yesterday, probably for the 100th time.
Oh, thank
you. It is incredible. Now that you are the star of the movie, do you associate yourself with the extras that you work with?
Not allowed anywhere near me. Different bus, different. It's like a cage we keep them in. We water them and stuff, but no, there's no chance. Yeah, of course. I'm. I'm gonna go. No, I'm still Jenny from the block.
It is incredible, though, because I work behind the scenes and worked with extras very closely for a long time, and you've kind of tapped into the reality of it.
Well,
because
there's
so many.
You know, it's a cross section of society. There's smart ones that do it for a laugh, and there's ones that are a little bit more bewildered that don't quite know what they're doing. But on the whole, they're a good bunch, and we've been very lucky. I mean, we promoted some extras. They get lines towards the end because you look out for that. And with the stuff me and Steve do, we want realism. So sometimes real people can give us something better than a trained actor who might pick up symptoms. And if I'm giving false hope to anyone, you've got no chance. You can't be in the next series now.
You've got these great superstars get involved now. Do you go to them? They come to you, presumably.
No, I go to them. When we come up with things like, let's have George Michael cruising in the bushes, Steve goes, you can ask him? I go, yep. Yeah, and I call them up and say, I've got a great idea. Yeah. And they all said yes.
Is there anyone on the wish list at this point?
We are thinking of doing another one, but only if we've got a lot to beat. You know, we had Ben Stiller and, you know, they're there. And Robert De Niro.
What about this woman? Can you get this woman on?
Well, she couldn't do it. She was up for it, but she couldn't do it. So maybe we could revisit that idea. And I want Al Pacino. I definitely, there's one of the last great, I think, Hollywood icons.
Some great work on the DVD, this one from Big Brother.
No, I'm not having a go. I'm not having a go. I'm just saying we must be desperate. Why else would we come onto a show where you have to hand in your dignity at the door?
I haven't handed in my dignity.
But you just feel so sorry for him, Ricky.
I know. They
What's
were great,
happen,
though.
Andy?
They were fantastic.
Are we going to see him come back again? Have you got plans now for Andy as a character?
We haven't yet. We're going to see if if a new one has got legs. We're not going to do it for the sake of it. We've never done that. But if we've got, this overwhelming urge to tell a new story, I think that, unlike The Office, we're never saying never. Mm. We thought maybe, you know, the next thing would make him going to try and make it in Hollywood or trying to do the remake. Because that's a whole new. He's always got to be at the bottom rung of the ladder. That's the important thing.
Yeah.
You can never really. No one wants to see unfeasibly, clever people doing well. There's got to be a struggle, and that's what we identify with in comedy, the empathy, the underdog.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, it is brilliant. Just over 2 weeks to Children in Need, big night. Did you know that?
I did. Yeah, 14th of November, isn't it?
Well
that is
done.
Correct.
Yes.
Well
yes.
done.
He's been... It's in my diary. I mean, I do too much for charity. But, it's just, my diary's just full of that sort of stuff.
Special diary just for the charity stuff.
Yeah. Listen, well, that...
Don't film this.
I'll stop that.
Look, you're dropping it all over.
Tonight, we're going to Phil Toffin will meet up with some of the kids who benefit from us and Ricky, mainly putting our hands in our pockets.
The One Show's Pennies for Pudsey appeal is asking you to get rid of all your loose change that you've just got lying around. But where does the money go?
There we go. Thank you very much for donating all of that cash, Ricky. It's very, very kind.
But I don't want to talk about it.
But he's put some proper change. Anyone's coming with a
Well, they said, no, they said don't bring in loose change. And I thought it was like a real thing. I didn't know I was meant to do it on air. And it was like, but we really did clean all our drawers out. We went round getting everything. Actually, my girlfriend did it all. I just sort of went, yeah, more. And she was just emptying pockets.
That's really, really sweet. If we'll put that in later on.
We'll get to the next thing. Busy yourself.
There's silver in there as well. That's not all coppers.
Thank you, Ricky.
All the details of how to donate are on the website.
Yeah. Giles, showing us the silver. Giles Brandreth has been regularly pining on the One Show for the things we're on the verge of losing. He's already lamented the past...
Wow. I am rolling along on the crest of their enthusiasm, their energy, their commitment, their capacity. They are just amazing. When next you hear people running down the state of British youth, just think of the youngsters in the gang show.
Giles, if you're watching, Ricky here was genuinely disappointed that you weren't joining us here today. We can all for you to meet Giles.
I know, I'd love to meet Giles, yeah. I'm just putting some money in the old...
We want a showbiz exclusive from
you. Yeah, we do,
Ricky. What? Yeah. The question is, are you hosting the Oscars? Big fanfare? Let's do that at fanfare again.
Yeah,
are you?
Almost certainly not.
Oh.
Well, they
not even a definite no.
Well, no. Well, it's. I tell you what, it's probably a no because one, I probably won't get asked. They said I'm on the list. I don't know where on the list I am. Probably 133. And then I don't even know if it's right for me. But I don't want to give too much away because I want to be asked.
Yeah.
I don't want to put them off asking me. I want to be invited.
You know? We'll start the campaign. So the One Show theme tune continues to get some of you overexcited. Frankly, I think it's the lyrical simplicity of it that appeals.
Yeah.
It's just the one word, Christine.
It is. It's one.
That's the fella.
Something like
You've
that.
Sent us clips of your. And Dearest performing it, young, old, but just spot the talent here.
Oh, yes. Please welcome Hector and his owners, Ryan and Rosie. Yes. Hello. Hello, Hector.
Does Hector enjoy the show? It was a howl of pain to me that he wanted it to stop.
He quite enjoys it, yeah. I mean, he does it every time. It doesn't matter where he is. He can be lying in bed and he just starts singing every time.
Oh, that's really lovely.
Can we have another bash now? Let's just put the theme tune on again. Hector? Hector, listen.
Oh.
Hector, with respect, thanks for coming, but that was rubbish. You can get any old dog to come on and bark. Oh, you're supposed to howl. What other programmes does he like?
Murder, She Wrote and Neighbours. So, yeah, anything with a bit of brass in it. And Toy Story, he loves
any
Toy
sort
Stories.
Of Randy Newman. Newman music. Bugs Life, Toy Story. Anything a bit orchestral.
Yeah. Yeah. Apart from the One Show theme, yeah. Tonight, that's it.
Well, we're going to give him another bash to howl us out of the show.
In a second. Thank you very much, folks. There we go, Hector. Yeah. Thank you.
Ricky, no, thanks very much for coming in.
Ricky. Yeah. Thank you
upstaged
so
by a dog again.
Yeah. No.
Good luck with Ghost Town. The box sets out next week. Tomorrow, Hardeep on the history of the Bond baddie. Holby City's sexiest surgeon, Amanda Mealing, as well.
Well, take it away, Hector.
Go on, Hector.
Sorry, guys.
Too much sport on television? Well, not for everyone, you know. X-rays on the case, next.